So now let's take a use case. Let's take a pattern. Let's try to bring it all this together, right? Let's try to take a use case, a pattern which we have done sometime back. And I'm going to take an example of this particular use case. I have done this project at least twice in two different clients, huge clients. Pretty much every client, every business is interested in this. They have customers and they're keen to know whether the customer is happy or unhappy. Why are they so anxious about it? Why do companies want to know that?
So that they can be unhappy, engaged.
They can make unhappy customers happy, engage customers. That's right. What else? That's a huge wealth of information on that. That's one piece of it.
They can attract more customers and retain more customers.
They can attract more customers, retain customers, right? Okay.
And
what else?
Increase the profit
indirect by doing all those things. They increase the profit. What else? There's tons of.
How to convert unhappy to happy?
I think people are focusing on that so much, right? I think unhappy to unhappy. Actually, I did this project in the first banking client, and the VP of that really opened my eyes. It's a wrong thing to do. I mean, we can still debate, but she opened my eyes phenomenally. What she said, this unhappy, the grumpy person out there, don't even worry about him. Don't even worry. Yes, it's right that customer is right and you should do everything, but that customer is already zero. Like, that's not a customer for you. And whatever amount of effort you put in, it will become one, possibly chances of that. Mostly unhappy. Mostly it's very, very hard to change perception. And I will tell you, this relates to many, many places. I'm not going to go there, but hopefully you take that point. This person who is happy, she said, I'm focusing on this one. I'm not interested in that person, that unhappy person. I'm focused on this guy who is happy because there's already one customer. It's so easy for me to go back and say, oh, there is other products and services which we have. Will you buy? The answer is going to be most likely yes. That other person saying, forget it. I'm even returning this product. What are you talking about buying another product? If you go to this engaged person, very happy person, and tell him, like, can you refer friends and family? Very likely that will happen. So that one can go almost like infinity. So the focus, I think, suddenly our mind changed, and we changed the product project itself from customer retention to customer engagement. And we started thinking from that angle. So very insightful, very knowledgeable. There is value to this. Of course, you cannot underestimate the value of the challenge. In fact, that's a covering your losses because that person can be negative. That's the bigger drawback. But otherwise, focus. If you keep focusing the right way on this and keep doing whatever this is happening, there's much better chances. So just a side fight into that. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask you all to help me solve the problem, right? What is the problem? Let's define the problem so that everybody's solving the same problem, right? Not a different problem. What is the problem in front of us right now?
How to make
sell more products and everything. Let's keep the machine learning world. The problems are very simple, very simple. You are taking one task and saying, this is cat image, this is dog image. This is happy customer, this is unhappy customer. That's what machine learning is. Machine learning is not, that is AI. When it started to get sophisticated and try to do all those things, that's where it comes to difference. And we'll talk about that later point if interest is there. But here, let me rephrase the problem so that everybody's solving the same problem. The problem is, we want to identify, actually predict a customer, even a new customer comes in, forget about existing customer. If a new customer comes in, I want to, based on the patterns, estimate already, like, this customer is going to be happy or unhappy. Just the new customer itself. I don't have any background, but just by looking at that, that's the beauty of machine learning. Existing customer, it's somewhat easy. Other systems have been doing it. You have so many complaints. Yeah, this customer is unhappy. The beauty is when you predict for new customers, right? And just a few thought process just to so that help others to see how that is possible. It is all possible. In the common sense world, is like, let's say there are people who are living in the same region where their bank has less ATMs and they're not happy to withdraw. That could be one reason they go living in that same location, unable to have ATMs. Various reasons. I'm just giving you an example to think about it. But again, our problem is predicting whether a customer is going to be happy or unhappy. Everybody okay with that? Let's not solve different problems. That's very important. Now, what I have done is giving you very basics. So that's why I'm going to help you a little bit and give you something called as a cheat sheet, right? We'll cheat there a little bit. I'll share this cheat sheet with you, so don't stress out on that. There are tons of these cheat sheets. This is by Microsoft Azure, but there are so many of them. It doesn't necessarily have to apply to Azure. It can be used anywhere, right? It's a general one. In fact, Microsoft has taken this one down and taken another one. I don't know why. But I don't like that one. It's not so intuitive as this one is. The reason I like it, because I've been doing this CCR model for quite some time. And when you look back here, the first C, what was that in the CCR? Classification. Good, thank you. For all this part is classification, whether it's multi-class or two-class, it's classification, this section, the right half. The second C was clustering. So this section over here, the purple area over here. Then R was, so this whole section is regression. So it pretty much maps out very well, except for this anomaly detection. It's anomaly, right? So we can keep it aside for now. But this big CCR maps out very well. And the good thing, it's a cheat sheet. It's a very systematic flow chart. So you can start from the starting point, go step by step, and keep on getting your answer, right? So we will start from the starting point, and I'm going to ask you guys a bunch of questions. And based on that, we'll traverse like a game, right? So we'll start with this, the starting point. The first question is, are we predicting some future data points in this our use case? Whatever problem you're solving?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Good. So we are predicting some data point. So we can move on the yes path for this. We moved in here, right? Again, some people may be thinking a little different, but it's predicting. That's why I helped you to think through it and make sure everybody's solving the same problem. Otherwise, it's too hard. The next question is, what are we predicting? We are predicting categories or values? Categories. Everybody okay with that? Great. Thank you. So we move to the categories section. How many categories are we predicting?
Two.
So by just doing this simple logic and coming up to here, we have reached the two-class classification stage. With just the basic knowledge which I gave you and the cheat sheet, nobody's going to take you away from you all this, right? In fact, you don't even need the cheat sheet. Honestly, if you put in your head very well that regression is for values, this is for that, and all of those hints, you don't even need that. But maybe to start with, it's pretty good. So you reached this point. Now your question is, how do I pick the algorithms, right? And that's where I left you. I did not give you that. Now, the good news is, even if you arbitrarily picked any of them, you're going to be right. You're going to still be right, but you have reached only right till the weatherman level. I call that as a weatherman, right? The weatherman, a woman, says it's going to rain, and it does not rain, and they do not lose their job. Why? It's a prediction. It's a probability because there's a number they say. There's a 20% chance. We did not say there's a guarantee of rain. There is a 20% chance, right? That's kind of the coverage. It's a prediction kind of a thing model. Now, this exercise after this is you are 20% right, almost there, right? How do you get better and better? That's the exercise of the data scientist and the machine learning effort, which is trying to get it better and better. Just up to this, you're going to be right. There's no question about it. The question is how much right? That's kind of a thing. And just to add more to it, it's not that as simple as thing. I took a very atomic and simple model and simple example. Our example is good, actually very classic and great example, but it's not the iteration which it happens. So it's not like you'll go through this flow and say, I'm going to use this two class SVM, right? That's not the done. Data scientists are not magically going to do. What they'll probably actually do is they'll take this one, different algorithm, four or five different algorithms, try it out. It's not rocket science. They will try it out and look at the accuracy, look at the model, look at the numbers and all the background, what is coming, which one is doing the thing, change, tweak. It's like the fine dialing exercise, like let's do in the radio frequency, let's add the AM frequency. Just keep on dialing it and get better and better and better kind of thing. There's no magic crystal ball which any data scientist is having. That's the process that they go. Any questions on that? So excellent job, everybody thinking through that, and hopefully it gives you the mindset at a very high level. In an hour, I don't think so. That's nothing beyond that is possible.
It's all about experimentation and doing experimentation, like you get more data and then becoming more
recurring
towards
the... Very true. So the big blocks, there are two things. How can you get better? By not only algorithm, choosing the right algorithms. People get hung up with algorithms and models kind of thing. That's least trivial. I think the bigger piece is data. Do you have the right data? If you have all bad data and then best algorithm, you're still going to get garbage, right? Garbage in, garbage out, what we say. So it's not that your algorithm, best algorithm can magically do. If it is going to predict on the wrong data, so let's say I'll take an example. Let's say a model is trying to predict whether to give you a bank loan or not, right? That's a model, that's what it's doing. Bank is whether you applied for a home loan, you get it or not. The model is predicting that. The algorithm is doing that. But if the model is only given information, the question or the data, as such. Your favorite color, your favorite food, and your favorite sports car or something. This is the only information if you give the model. What do you think the model can do? Not much. It will say all the red people are getting this thing and the people who like Thai cuisine are getting loans. What can it do? You've given it wrong data. I'm just taking an exaggerated extreme example to make you think through that. The data plays actually much more example. If I have all the right data, and even if algorithm, not even an algorithm, a simple report will be able to do something a better job. So the data is more important and less important is the algorithm. But the shiny thing gets the attention, which is the algorithm. Was it helpful? Does it make sense? Yeah? Everybody able to correlate how these pieces start coming together? Very, very systematic and approach that I'm trying to make, but it's a simple, keeping it simple as well. So people may feel simplistic, but you've got a lot. Believe me, you know more than 90% of the people on the planet.